now to the part of the program where we have Eugene Meehan, our next presenter, speaking on the issue of Supreme Court of Canada update and powerful written advocacy. Eugene Meehan, QC, is the head of Supreme Advocacy LLP. And Eugene has enjoyed a varied career. He's been a professor at a law school. He acted as the executive legal officer to Chief Justice Lemaire of the Supreme Court of Canada. And he worked in appellate advocacy at a national law firm. He's been involved in over 1,000 cases at the Supreme Court of Canada. He writes factum, he argues cases, and he strategizes with counsel who have cases in the Supreme Court of Canada or in the various appellate courts across the country. He's going to be giving a Supreme Court of Canada update, the top personal injury and insurance cases from 2019 and 2020. He will also be giving a presentation on how to write more persuasive advocacy, which appears to be our new reality in the post-COVID context. There may be occasions in the future where your only appearances in court will be through Zoom technology, or perhaps you'll have to rely totally on your written advocacy because there will be no court appearance whatsoever. And Eugene is going to talk about how that's going to impact on our role as advocates for our client. He's going to comment on how that's going to impact on access to justice and who the winners and losers of the reality. So Eugene, take it away from there.
Okay, great. Thank you, Gary. And thank you, Brandon, for recording this. Significant personal and insurance cases from 2019 through to 2020. The Supreme Court of Canada has been very busy in this area over the last 2 years. So what I'm going to tell you here is there's 16 appeals, one oral judgment, two appeals heard with judgment reserved, eight leaves to appeal granted. That's with all since 2019 and 2020 so far. That's 27 altogether. There's a lot to deal with, too much to deal with actually. So I'm going to give you a one line summary on each. Yes, I know that that's a lot. It's boring as well, but there is a paper. The paper is 36 pages. It's better that I not read that to you. You can read it at your leisure. And besides which, you can read faster than I can talk. And if you want the factum or the facta in all of these cases for both sides or indeed multi-sides, because some of the cases have multi-sides plus interveners, I've got them all, so you can email me for any of these. So through this real fast, you may want to put your seatbelt on because we're going to go through them number one, two, three, etc. So very briefly, kind of like a one-line summary for each of these cases, and then you can dig more deeply into the cases. And you'll see from the paper, if you want to read the paper, is that I've done it up in such a way that it's not overly discursive, that it's kind of like going back to law school in first year. So there's a summary of the facts, what happened below, what the issues were, what the courts below said, and what the Supreme Court of Canada said, what the holding was in summary, and then a key quote. And it's all done the same way. So it makes it a lot easier to follow and it makes it very accessible. So here's the fast, boring part for which I apologize in advance. Number one is civil procedure torts jurisdiction. This came down February 28, 2020 of this year. The respondents were Eritrean refugees who sought to bring a representative claim against the applicant, which was a publicly held BC corporation. The Supreme Court of Canada, by majority, said that the state of act of state doctrine was not part of Canadian law, but that customary international law is part of Canadian law, and Canadian courts can find Canadian companies responsible for violating it. And then it was sent back to the trial judge to determine the various, what the court called specific norms in this case. Number two, Civil Procedure Class Actions Jurisdiction, JW et al. Versus AG Canada. This case came down April 12, 2019. In this particular case, give me just a moment. This was a settlement. So it's an important case in terms of settlement. And even though it involved the residential schools case, the language of the case is strong in the sense that where there is a settlement, the court still can have what the Abella, I believe, wrote, said judicial supervision plays a critical role in ensuring that the claimants receive the benefits they were promised. So a lot of people think settlement is over, you can't go back to court. You can go back to court. Number three, civil procedure in Quebec, actions against police. This came down November 29, 2019. The case is called Kosoyan and it's versus the Société de Transport de Montréal. In this particular case, a woman was arrested, stopped and searched for not holding the handrail, and I believe going down into the metro, because she didn't fail a warning saying that you should hold the handrail. The Speaker of Canada said that there was no law saying people had to hold the handrail. The picture was a warning, and that they therefore the police were without jurisdiction. Number four, class actions, arbitration clauses. This is the Uber Technologies case, June 26, 2020 of this year. The Supreme Court of Canada held that the standard arbitration clause for Uber is unconscionable and therefore invalid. Number five, class actions certification. Pioneer Corp, September 20, 2019. In this case, the Supreme Court held that here the class action can go ahead. Consumers who have bought from other companies besides the respondents could be part of the class. The majority also said that the two-year limitation deadlines could be extended since the respondents hid what they were doing so that other consumers could not find out. Number six, class actions in Quebec certification. This case is Laurentoir Saint-Joseph de Montréal versus an individual whose name is abbreviated to JJ. The Supreme Court said that it was not too late for JJ to sue. They noted that Quebec had a new three-year time limit to sue if the abuser or victim died. And the judges noted that the changes to the law were meant to make it easier for victims of sexual abuse to get justice, not harder. Number seven, class actions in Quebec, certification of punitives. This is the Volkswagen case. It came down November 13, 2019. In this particular case, the Quebec Superior Court granted an application for authorization to institute, that's the way it's called in Quebec, a class action in part, including authorizing one for punitive damages. The Supreme Court of Canada said that the Superior Court of Quebec did not err in exercising her discretion and dismissed the appeal from the Quebec Court of Appeal. Eight, class actions, video lottery. This is the Atlantic Lottery case. It came down July 24, 2020 of this year. The Supreme Court of Canada held that the certification order in this case should be set aside and the plaintiff's claim struck in its entirety. Number nine, Constitutional Law Division of Powers. It's a case that came down November 29, 2019, Dingane Transport. This involved marine engine parts. So you may think marine law, maritime law, federal jurisdiction. Well, the Supreme Court of Canada held that a provincial contract law applied in this particular case and made reference to what is called a double aspect scenario. Number 10, environmental law, downstream pollution, corporate transfers. This case came down December 6, 2019. Resolute FP Canada is the name of the case. In this particular case, give me just a moment to flip the page here. There was an indemnity and the court held that this was intended to cover only pollution claims brought by third parties, that first party regulatory claims, such as the remediation order, do not fall within the scope of the indemnity. Number 11, labor law, definition of workplace. This is Canada Post, came down December 20, 2019. This case held by the Supreme Court of Canada that Canada Post, that the workplace was only what Canada Post controlled. So that was the depot itself, not the mail routes, nor the places where the mail got delivered. Number 12, labor employment law, employee versus independent contractor, came down May 3, 2019, Modern Cleaning Concept, it's a Quebec case. This was a franchise dispute. You may think, okay, the person that is a franchisee is not an employee, they're an independent contractor or another capacity in Quebec. Wrong. The Supreme Court of Canada held that this is a fact-specific, contextual inquiry. And here, the individual, the franchisee, was an artisan, making him an employee for legal purposes. Number 13, pensions in Quebec, presumption of life, Threfall versus Carleton University. This involved the interpretation of what's called a life-only pension. And because it's life-only, you have to be alive, obviously. The person was missing, presumed dead later. The court dealt with all of that. The money had to be paid back to Carleton. And the court went into what the three essential elements were to claim a receipt under the Quebec Civil Code. 14, tax back bank document disclosure. It's a number company case out of Alberta, heard January 22. Judgment came down June 27, 2019. In this particular case, the court held that, in this case it was National Bank, that you do not treat a bank's branches as distinct from the bank itself. And the Quebec tax officials were allowed to send a letter demanding information to a bank branch, even though that branch was in Alberta. Number 15, torts, wrongful imprisonment. This is Fleming versus Ontario, October 4, 2019. The court below, the trial judge, said that there was less invasive options that could have defused the situation here and awarded almost 140K in general damages. The Supreme Court of Canada applied the ancillary powers doctrine, allowed the appeal and restored the trial judge's order. 16, wills and estates in Quebec, discretionary trusts. It's a Quebec case, but it may be relevant in terms of what's covered and not covered by a trust. I used to teach trust law, and part of the judgment here is a little surprising in that the Supreme Court of Canada held by majority, I might go with a dissent on this one, that the that trustees do not own the property in a trust. The control they have over it may give them, quote, rights which confer use. And that was relevant as to whether the value of the home is included in family patrimony for Quebec purposes. Those are the main appeal judgments. Let me very briefly just give you the headings for the remainder, the remaining ones coming up. Oral judgments, there was one called De Jong, dealing with torts and fraud, and that dealt with the corporate attribution rules. There were two appeals heard, judgment reserved. One was dealing with class actions in Quebec, to dealing with contractual and extra contractual liability. There was another one, also class actions, and towards dealing with the duty of care involving a listeria outbreak at a Maple Leaf Foods establishment. And then there's leaves to appeal granted. There was eight total. Some of these, the appeal is scheduled to be heard. Number one, Aboriginal law flooding and fiduciary duties. That's scheduled to be heard December 8th of this year. Number two, civil procedure limitation periods discoverability. A very significant case out of New Brunswick called Grant Thornton. Many of these our firm is directly involved in, including this one. I don't bother telling you all of that. But there's a lot of significant cases coming up. Number three, class actions towards duty of care. This is the cooperator's case that's scheduled for December 7, 2020 to be heard. Number four, insurance coverage, alcohol prohibition and estoppel, that was discontinued May 11 of 2020, even though leave to appeal was granted. Number five, insurance and releases, what is released, what is not, City of Corner Brook. And number six, MedMal, a significant MedMal case there, Armstrong versus Ward. Number seven, torts, misdemeanors in public office, police versus prosecutors. That's scheduled to be heard October 15. Number eight, torts, municipal law, snow removal, to Canadian case. That one is not yet scheduled to be heard. And that's it. Tons of cases, 36 pages, some of it sleep-inducing, sorry, but in their day job, very important. That's it.